It's that time of the week when former football and sports stars share their stories. It happens all right here, right now, on Thursday Night Tailgate. With your hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. Guys, have some fun. Enjoy the guests. Take it away.
Hey, thank you, Joe. Good evening, everybody, and thank you for coming back and joining us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate, home of the NFL Alumni Association and the Gridiron Greats. TNT is brought to you by the great folks over at Kyven Foods, Coastal Orthopedics, the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory, and the French Lick Resort. I'm your host, Chris Mascaro, and tonight my co-host, Bob Lazzari, and I have a great show in store for you. Others in the media, and maybe some folks around the league as well, maybe saying that the running back position is becoming devalued, but we have four former running backs joining us tonight who might feel a little bit differently about that. We'll also be joined by one of the Cowboys legends, their very first draft pick in franchise history, as a matter of fact. So first up tonight, we're going to get a return visit from former Chargers and Falcons fullback Fred McCrary. Fred has been outspoken about the toll of the game has taken on him and taken on his peers as well. We'll hear his thoughts on that. Plus, we'll get his thoughts on the Falcons this season. Fred's going to be along with us about 15 minutes from now. Then former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins. You know he's here with us every week around 8:30 p.m. Eastern time. We'll get Tony's thoughts this week on Doug Flutie. What was that like when Flutie came to the Patriots back in the late 80s? Plus, we'll get his insights, into the Patriots' current crop of running backs. You have to believe it. They'd be relying heavily on those guys as Brady sits out his four-game suspension at the beginning of the season. So we'll talk about that and a whole lot more when Tony's here with us at the bottom of the hour. Following Tony, another Patriots running back, JR Redmond, will be back with us. So we'll talk to him and get his thoughts on the Patriots as well. He recently wrote on social media about the warm reception that he still gets from Patriots fans when he goes back, whether it's for training camp or a game up there in New England. So we'll talk about that as well. We'll also chat about his time at Arizona State and the great players that he got to play with when he was there. So JR will be with us a little bit later in this hour. We'll kick off hour number two with our fourth running back of the night. That's former Dolphins, Eagles, and Chargers running back Ronnie Brown. He'll be back with us. Looking forward to catching up with Ronnie. We'll hear what he thinks about, the Dolphins and the Chargers, get his insights on them on this upcoming season and what they need to do to get over the hump and be playoff contenders. We'll also get his thoughts on Cam Newton, they're both former Auburn alums, or current Auburn alums, if you will. So we'll talk a little bit about Cam Newton with him and see if he thinks that Cam is the best player in the NFL, which so many people are saying, in and out of the sport. So we'll get his thoughts on Cam and his alma mater as well, Auburn. Tough season last year, finished last in the SEC West. Can they bounce back from that? We'll hear what Ronnie thinks at the top of the next hour. And then we're going to round out the show with a visit from Cowboys Hall of Fame defensive tackle Bob Lilly. Very excited about having Bob Lilly as part of the show tonight. So we'll talk to him. Like I said a moment ago, he was the Cowboys' very first, their first ever draft pick back in 1961. What was that like? We'll hear Bob's thoughts on that. Plus, what it was like a couple of times a year against Jim Brown and the Cleveland Browns. Back then, they played teams like Cleveland twice a year. That was back in the early 60s. So he had to face Jim Brown twice a season. What was that like? And we'll also talk to him about part of the Cowboys' first Super Bowl championship team back in 1971. Also want to talk to Bob about they had to play 2 days after JFK was assassinated. So, the assassination happens 2 days later. The Cowboys have to play a football game. And what was that like based on, the mood of the country and, how devastated everybody was at the loss of a president? So we'll talk about that as well. Bob's going to join us about 90 minutes from now. So we've got a really great show in store for you tonight. So sit back, relax. Let us take your mind off everything else going on in your life for the next couple of hours. But the best thing that we get to do all night long is bring in my co-host, Mr. Bob Lazzari. Bob, how are you tonight, my friend?
Doing okay, Chris. How about yourself?
Very well, thank you. As we were talking off air, out here in Phoenix, where it was a balmy 115 today, heat index all included, and came out here just in time to get their monsoon season. So they've had a bit of rain as well. So not only it's a dry heat, not this time of year, 115, it's every bit of it, my friend, with the heat and humidity. And it's been an interesting stay so far out here in Phoenix. One more night to go. And I'm in the shadow of University of Phoenix Stadium, where the Arizona Cardinals play. So it's been fantastic so far, my friend.
That's excellent. Again, I hope you have a safe trip back, Chris, and it's good that we could continue the show from afar. We are about as far as you can get, from Phoenix to Hartford.
That's right. We are in extremes. I think the only time would have been any further is when we did the Pro Bowl out in Hawaii. So if we'd have had you join in from there, I think that would have been the extremes of how far you could get apart in this country.
Yeah. I made the trip, and I know.
So, Bob, I wanted to get your thoughts on the Hall of Fame induction ceremonies from last weekend and the game being called off due to the field conditions. But first, I want to thank you, Brett Favre's speech, which was incredibly moving, Bob. You know, talking about the tough love that he got from his father. We know he lost his father a few years back, several years back, I guess at this point. Plus, he talked about not being perfect, but that he gave it everything that he had, has no regrets, which I think is fantastic. And then he said that's what he's most proud of. He has no regrets when he looks back over the course of his career. Curious to get your thoughts, Bob, on what you heard and saw during Brett's speech.
Well, I watched both him and Green's speeches, Chris, live, and then I watched both of them again this morning to see if I missed anything or whatever. And they were both incredible speeches. And, I'm not normally one of these big guys who would dissect speeches. And you would think... when we look back, a 37-minute speech by anyone going into any Hall of Fame would have been too much to handle, right, Chris? I mean, that's a long time when you think about it. But when you watched Favre's speech, it did not seem like 37 minutes. And the way he did it, without really looking at his notes at all, and kind of did it in an incredible order. You know, he went from his family, and he led to his, went from his specific family members, mother, father, and then went to, of course, started out with his wife, and very moving. And you could see him break down a few times, and that was about as real as it can get. And he's as blue-collar as a guy as I think you and I probably ever come across. I wrote a column on him, a thank you letter to him, when he went out the first time. I know he came back, but basically this was basically done about all his, everything he did in Green Bay was pretty much my shtick, and what he meant to that town, I think that was kind of downplayed a little bit in the speech, and of course, because he had probably go to Minnesota, I don't think it took any shine off it, because you saw, Chris, those Packer fans in the audience were incredible, and I don't think really he even had to acknowledge them. He probably could have said, I don't need to say anything. Look at these people out here, the cheeseheads and everything. But, again, the speech itself, Chris, from the heart, tells you how much of a blue-collar background he came from. I started thinking of, and tearing up because I was thinking of my own father, very, very similar as far as being low on praise, being very demanding, and when you look back on it after they're long gone, everything they did was to make you a better person and a better whatever you're doing in life, and that's what I got out of that speech. It was an incredible moment.
Yeah, it really was, Bob, and I tell you what, between a couple of recent events related to Brett, the speech being the most important one. And then I, not that long ago, I went back and I looked at, John Gruden has his, quarterback camp, and then you can watch, he's got different players. Typically he's going through the rookies and taking them through the exercises and all that sort of thing. But he recently had Brett Favre on that. And, looking at the old, game films and things of that nature when they were both in Green Bay and just watching Favre and listening to him and, he remembers the plays. I mean, they go into games, and he remembers the play call. He remembers the play and who did what and all of that sort of stuff. I mean, his memory is unbelievable. And I tell you what, Bob, and they talk about in that group episode, because Favre has sort of taken some young kids. Plus, they had Antonio Freeman back, and he's taken some kids through some exercises. And Favre is, Gruden is calling a play, and they run the simulated play, and his arm strength is every bit as good right now as it ever was. And they make not, and Favre acknowledges that, he's like, it's not the arm, this is the problem. He's like, I just don't want to get hit anymore, right? But, you know, he could literally still, you know, put a chin strap on or a helmet on and go out there and play and be effective if it wasn't for all of the hitting, at least, for, you know, based on, you know, how, you know, making the throws. He could still make all of the throws. But I tell you what, that speech I thought was just absolutely incredible. And to your point, Bob, it was genuine and real. And I don't, you know, maybe he had notes. I never saw, to your point, I never saw him refer to them. I never saw him, you know, kind of scan down. What am I supposed to, who am I supposed to thank next? What am I supposed to say next? Where am I in my speech? I never referenced that either. And it just seemed like, you know, he just got up there and spoke from his heart. He knew, you know, who he wanted to thank and that sort of thing. And he just got up there and spoke whatever he, you know, whatever came to his mind, you know, to say. And I just thought, this is a classic all-time speech. What a great job I thought he did.
And, you know, Chris, the ironic part of it is, and he even alluded to it in his speech, he was never one, he was always sports over education for him at times. But the way he presented that speech was one of the more intelligent, it came across as one of the more intelligent, eloquent things that you'll ever see under tough circumstances. As if, as he said during the speech, this is harder than any 3rd and 15 I ever had. So it was just incredible. You know, I that's one of those things where I'll go back and watch it every once in a while. Well, you need a gut check.
Yeah.
That was just tremendous.
Absolutely it was. I agree 100% with that, Bob. The other one that came across to me, and you mentioned it a moment ago, Kevin Green, who's one of my all-time favorite players. And he went in as a Steeler. He only played 3 years of his 15 as a Steeler, but he went in as a Steeler, and I love him for that. And I just, you know, those 3 years, he was, you know, absolutely one of my favorite players. And I thought he did a great, you know, great job with his speech as well. I thought, you know, he came from a military family, and I love the salute he made to all those who serve in various ways, right? As he put it, you know, all the firefighters, the paramedics, the men and women in law enforcement, all the soldiers, the squids, the flyboys, the jarhead gyrenes, all those that stand tall for our beloved country anywhere, you know, across God's green earth. My family sleeps good at night under the canopy of freedom that you deploy. I salute you and thank you. I thought, wow, that's fantastic.
Oh, yeah, Chris, that was his speech was half as long as Favre's, but when you got into the nuts and bolts, when he started talking about his father, who was a major military guy, as you saw,
right,
and the upbringing he had, it kind of, both guys, it kind of explained why they played the way they did and why they're in Canton right now. It was incredible. I thought, of course, I thought Green's speech was a little on the lighter side, but that's him. He's just, I mean, both of them were, let's face it, free spirits, if you will. But Kevin Green, you know, it was great to see our buddy LeVon Kirkland there, Chris, and my goodness, they were right on the same page with everything he was saying and talking how he would not like to see his teammates, and they didn't like to see him make solo tackles, so everybody couldn't get in on it. That was pretty funny, but it was
right.
Tremendous stuff. It was just, and that's as real as it gets, too. No playing there with the military stuff either, Chris. He lived that kind of life and knows what his father did to sacrifice for his family and the country, and it came across very well.
Yes, it did. And as a matter of fact, it's interesting, Bob, when you mentioned LeVon Kirkland being there. LeVon actually wasn't there, and they actually put his name. They said he was there, but that wasn't him. That was a different team. And I forget, he actually, LeVon put out on social media who it was, and I wish I could remember. It was another one,
or
linebacker that he played with. But he's right next to Greg Lloyd, who was there.
Lloyd was the one, yes.
Yeah, Greg Lloyd was, yeah.
And
Greg's going to join us. I can't tell you, Bob, how excited I am. Greg Lloyd's going to join us in a few weeks. And you talk about, my two favorite players of all time being Jack Lambert and Greg Lloyd, and Kevin Green right in that group as well, as LeVon Kirkland and Chad Brown. I'm a linebackers guy. And we're going to have Greg on in a couple weeks. Chad Brown will be with us next week. So interested to hear what both of those guys have to say about Kevin Green's speech and remembering playing alongside of Kevin. So we'll certainly get into that with both of those guys when they join us here, like I say, over the next couple of weeks.
Yeah, and Chris, when you have the teams like the Steelers and the Packers, two of the legendary franchises, they had a ton of guys from both teams, and you could get lost in the shuffle there. LeVon Kirkland could have been there, and nobody would have known. But, I mean, it was incredible to watch, and That was a great feel-good story, man. Just those two guys, I was emotional enough where I was just spent. So it was well worth it.
Yes, it was. Bob, before we move on, updates on guests for your show, Monday Night Sports Talk, do you do along with our friend Tony D'Angelo?
Oh, yeah, we did a show this past Monday night. Chris, baseball historian Dick Graham came on, told us a guy is like a Kreskin of baseball. It was amazing just hearing this guy because he goes back to the 50s. But he was terrific. And then we talked to Christina Scleros, who was the Yankees' good luck charm back in 96. Every time she sang the national anthem as an 8-year-old, they either came back from losing to win, and even in the playoffs in the World Series when she sang, and she went on to a great career off Broadway and things like that. It was a very interesting show, Chris.
Nah, very good. All right, folks, be sure to check out Bob and Tony and their show again. It's called Monday Night Sports Talk. You can stream or you can download any of their archive episodes. You can find them online, mondaynightsports.net, or on their YouTube channel, Monday Night Sports. All right, like we do every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate, folks, we want to send out a big hello and an even bigger thank you to our military personnel that are listening in around the world on the Armed Forces Radio Network. We cannot say thank you enough for doing what you do to protect all of us and our way of life. For everyone else listening in, we appreciate you as well, and we hope you'll join us in thanking our brave men and women that are serving in every branch of the military. If you happen to see a member of our military, whether you know you're out and about in your daily life, whether it's in the airport, in a restaurant, at the grocery store, please stop for a moment and tell them thank you. They are our true heroes. We also want to thank our veterans for your service and the sacrifices that you and your families have made for us over the years. Big thank you as well to Sean Cruz and the wonderful folks over at the Armed Forces Radio Network. It is such an honor for us to have Thursday Night Tailgate as a part of your network. You can find our show by going to armedforcesradionetwork.org. And veterans, please continue to check out globalvoiceforveterans.org for news and articles that are both interesting and beneficial, specifically geared towards you. Again, it's globalvoiceforveterans.org. TNT is brought to you by the great folks over at Kyven Foods, owned and operated by our good friend, former Bengals and Falcons tight end and TNT Hall of Famer Reggie Kelly. If you want to be king of the grill this summer, folks, it is a must that you use Kyven Sweet Barbecue Sauce, which is ranked number 15 in the world by Barbecue Superstars. This barbecue sauce is a must for the big games your tailgating needs. It is available at select Walmarts and Krogers throughout the eastern half of the country. For locations, online orders, and recipes, check out their website at kyven82.com. And Kyven is spelled K-Y-V-A-N. And if your local Walmart doesn't carry the Kyven Sweet Barbecue Sauce, well, request it. I'm sure they'll be happy to add it to their shelves for you. TNT is also sponsored by Dr. Peter Candelora and the great folks over at Coastal Orthopedics. If you're dealing with joint pain, whether it's in your shoulders, your elbows, your hips, your knees, your feet, stop doing nothing and start to do what the gridiron greats do to get relief, and that is contact Coastal Orthopedics. They can get you back to enjoying life. For more information, check them out online at bone-dr.com. Baseball season, we're heading into the home stretch, right? If you love the game and you're looking for a great family late summer vacation destination, a weekend place to go, you're going to love the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory. It is a very cool experience for everyone in the family because you get to walk the live production line and see the bats being manufactured right there in front of you. They got a lot of cool exhibits. Still got the Ripley's Believe It or Not exhibit that has some bizarre baseball treasures that you get to check out. They recently unveiled the new life-size statue of Jackie Robinson, which is amazing. Don't miss the bat vault. You hear me bragging about that every single week here on TNT because you get to actually hold the game-used bats from so many of the game's greatest legends. You got to check that out. For more information about the museum and to book your visit, go to sluggermuseum.com. And folks, please don't forget our friends at the Gridiron Greats organization. Please help support a wonderful cause that's taking care of so many of the game's greatest legends. These are the guys that actually left them so many pieces of themselves out on the field. Remember, folks, these are the guys who played way back when they still had to get off-season jobs to help support themselves and their families. It's organizations like this one that was started by Mike Ditka. The Gridiron Greats are out there trying to help the guys we all grew up rooting for and reading about. And also, our friends at the French Lick Resort, you want to talk about a fantastic place to stay and play golf or just to simply relax and enjoy life. What a fantastic setting they have there at the French Lick Resort. Two great championship golf courses there, one designed by Pete Dye and the other by Donald Ross. The Pete Dye designed course hosted last senior PGA Championship and the LPGA Legends Championship. The Donald Ross design course was the site of Walter Hagen's PGA Championship victory back in 1924. They got a great spa right there in the hotel and a casino right there on the property as well, my friends. To find out more information and to book your stay, go to frenchlick.com. All right, we're getting ready to have Fred McCrary join us. He'll be along with us on the other side of these words from our friends over at Coastal Orthopedics.
Are you suffering from chronic pain in your shoulders, hips, knees, or wrists? Tired of living life with an old injury that just won't go away? If you answered yes to either of these questions, we can help. At Coastal Orthopedics and Sports Medicine, Dr. Candelora and his fine staff of medical professionals will get you back on the road to recovery. Their state-of-the-art facility and attention to detail will ensure you will be enjoying life again and feeling invincible in no time. Since 1991, Dr. Candelora and Coastal Orthopedics have been specializing in joint replacement, arthritis, and osteoporosis care, as well as pediatric and adult general orthopedics. Visit us on the web, www.bone-dr.com, or call our Newport Richey office just north of Tampa at 727-848-1417. Proud sponsors of Mike Ditka's The Gridiron Greats Assistance Fund.
Hello, everybody. Van Earl right here, reminding you that you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with the dynamic duo of Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari, right here on the Armed Forces Radio Network.
Now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Fred McCrary. Let me remind you about Fred's background. He's from Naples, Florida. In high school, he lettered in football, basketball, and track. He played his college ball at Mississippi State. He was a sixth-round draft pick in 1995 by the Philadelphia Eagles. He played fullback in the NFL from 1995 to 2007 for the Eagles, Saints, Chargers, Patriots, Falcons, and Seahawks. He was a member of the Patriots Super Bowl 38 championship team, and if you follow him on social media, you know he's got a heck of a golf swing as well, and we're very excited that he is back with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Fred, Chris and Bob here. Welcome back to the show.
Hey, Fred.
What's up, fellas? How you guys doing, man? What's going on?
All right.
Good.
So, Fred, speaking of that great golf swing that you had, I saw a few weeks back that you were playing in a golf tournament with Bo Jackson and another great friend of the show here, Victor Green, former Jets player. Got to ask, who walked away with all the money?
Oh, you're talking about the Bo Jackson celebrity tournament
yeah.
in Chicago. I don't know who won that tournament. I know neither one of us won, so...
who's better?
I have
you or Bo?
Oh, definitely me. All day. Bo knows. Bo don't know golf that well. He knows golf, but not well enough to beat me.
That's great. So
yeah, he knows golf, but not. Go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say. You know, I was going back through some interviews that you've done. You know, not in the not too distant past. Fred, and I was looking at an interview that you did along with some other guys with Larry King. And during that interview, you were talking about not wanting to, you know, to go see team doctors when you were injured, because if you went and saw the doc too many times, you could lose your job. So I'm curious, how does that start? Did you see that actually happening to guys when you were, you know, a young player coming into the league, or was that fear sort of passed down to you from other players?
No, you see it. Absolutely, you see it. And I think it's the way of the coaches and the guys upstairs, like the front office people, you say, hey, listen, if you get hurt too much, you're not going to be around. So it's your job to stay on the field. We're paying you a lot of money to stay on the field. So it's an old saying, you can't make the club in the tub. So, you know, it really is true. So it was that way of trying to weed people out. And make sure you stay on your P's and Q's. Exactly what it does,
mm-hmm.
and it works.
And in that same interview, Fred, you mentioned a product, Guardian Caps, that we're very familiar with, and you talked about, you know, kids wearing it to help protect them. And for those who don't know what a Guardian Cap is, it's actually an exterior piece that goes on the outside of the helmet that helps reduce the impact of helmet to helmet hits. But you talked about kids wearing it to help protect them from head injuries and in some youth leagues. But, you know, we've been advocating that, you know, for years, you know, at the college or the NFL levels. Why is the NFL so hesitant to go with an exterior helmet pad to help protect the player?
I don't know. Hey, but I don't know if you noticed. Hey, look at University of Georgia's wearing them. University of South Carolina's wearing them. Georgia Tech's wearing them. And I forgot, it's five major college teams are wearing them now. So that's great. Yeah.
Do you think are they going to be wearing them on game days, or is it just for practice? Do you know?
No, it's only for practice. It's only for practice. Yeah. Game day, they won't let them wear it during game day for whatever reason.
Why?
I think the Rydell, whoever the manufacturer of the helmet, has some issue with it, but it really works. Like, I just came from football practice right now. My kids wear them religiously. I won't let them practice without it.
That's great. So, you know, what kind of feedback? What are you seeing? You know, with respect to, you know, now that your kids are wearing it, you know, do you are they giving you information? Are you seeing things that make, you know, say, you know what, this actually does work? This isn't, you know, something that, you know,
yes,
people are making us wear or whatever. What are you hearing about the apparatus?
Yeah, it works amazing. It really works. Nothing prevents a concussion, but this helps reduce the rate of a concussion. You know what I mean? Especially like
mm-hmm.
with kids, their necks aren't strong enough. And the helmet is heavy. So you put something on when a kid falls back and hit his head on the ground, you got something to soften the blow. Or when a kid hits another kid's helmet, it softens the blow.
Right.
Indirectly disperses the energy through the guardian cap, which is amazing, man. So when I seen it, I was like, my kids are never wearing anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because like anything I can do to help, that's what I want. That's what I'm advocate for. You know, I'm really big on it. Anything I can do to help our next generation coming up, to help make football safer, that's what I'm about. You know,
right.
I'm all about protecting the kids.
Yeah, you know, and it's interesting, Fred. You know, I think a lot of people look at the violent hits, particularly, you know, that, you know, defensive backs and wide receivers dish out and absorb, but their hits aren't as frequent, you know, as the guys on the offensive and defensive lines who sort of go head to head, pun intended, on every play. But even worse than those collisions are the ones between, you know, the fullbacks where you played and linebackers, because you guys are hitting on every play, and on top of that, you're getting like a 5 yard running head start at one another, while, you know, the guys on the offensive line are about a yard apart. You guys get a full head of steam going. Remind people what it's like being a fullback taking on linebackers.
People have no idea how violent it is. Like, and you got to have some big cahoots to keep running up in there over and over and over and over. You know, you really do. You got to have some big cahoots to keep doing it. And it's no joke. You know, like, I cracked a helmet with the late Junior Seau. I cracked a helmet.
Wow.
From the exact thing you just talked about. 5 yards apart. He's 5 yards. He's full speed. I'm full speed. Pow! My helmet explodes.
Wow.
A big 4-inch crack across the top of my helmet. Let alone the amount of face mask I broke. You have no idea, like, how many face masks has been dented. You be like, man, you know how hard you got to hit to dent a face mask? It's pretty scary. Like, I'm the after effects, I'm sitting there saying, my God, what am I going to be like when I'm 55
right.
years old? It's pretty scary.
Bob, questions for Fred?
Fred, I got a headache just from listening to that. But I'm in my 50s, so I'll try to get over it quickly here. But, you know, a 95 season, Fred, here we are in the summer, training camps going on, and brutal heat up here in the Northeast today. But 95, you go to Philly. I just wanted to know what that first training camp was like under Ray Rhodes and John Gruden. Fred, give us an idea of what you remember from that.
I remember coming in, right? We had just signed Ricky Waters. You remember Ricky Waters, of course.
Oh, yes.
They was the big signee, and they bring the West Coast system in. Gruden was the offensive coordinator. Dude, I got some great stories about Gruden. Gruden and Ricky Waters, they went at it. The locker room was was the craziest thing as a rookie I've ever experienced. Put it that way. Rick and John Gruden pretty much almost went to blows. If Rick didn't get the ball enough, he was up in John Gruden's face. You punk MF, you better give me the ball. I'm going to kick your ass if you don't. And I'm as a rookie sitting there saying, my eyes are freaking big as some flying saucers. I'm like, they talk to the coach that way? No way. John Gruden used to get punked so bad. He used to get punked so bad. And I'm sitting there saying, there's no way this is how it's supposed to be in the NFL. But that's how it was with the Eagles. Hey, but one thing I can say, we played really hard for Ray. You know, we had his back, man. And he had our respect, too, you know?
Yeah, that's what we've heard from many people. And what a combination. There were some great coaches. Emmett Thomas, too, right, Fred? Was on that staff?
Emmett Thomas, our defensive coordinator. We had John Gruden, our offensive coordinator. Dick Jamison, he's passed away now. Charlie and Rick, he was our running back coach. Charlie and Rick took 15 years off his life. I'm telling you, he caught hell with Rick, Rick and Charlie. My God. Kevin Turner, remember Kevin Turner? He passed away too.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah, good friend of ours. Yes. Heartbreaking.
Yeah, that was he taught me how to block.
Wow.
And speaking of
that, we had Art Monk. We brought Art Monk in. Remember?
Wow. Huh? Yeah.
Yes.
Great name.
Yep.
Wow. And you mentioned the blocking, and Chris knows that tight ends and fullbacks, I have a soft spot for them, Fred, because you guys did the dirty work. You did not get the carries throughout your career. You were able to stay around 11 years with the lunch pail mentality. And knowing each year, Fred, probably going into every season, that you weren't going to be carrying the ball, you're basically going to just be blocking for somebody else. How did you prepare in the off season? I mean, is there blocking drills you can do? I mean, how did you spend your off seasons each year preparing for the upcoming year?
I did a ton of footwork. I did a ton of neck. I did my neck every single day, pretty much. Just stripping my neck from all the hits. So, you know, I worked out hard in the off season, but Sayal taught me this. You have to work out just as hard during the season so you can last. So that's the mentality I took. Rodney Harrison did it. I did it. Jamal Williams did it. Like, we had a group that got up every single morning and worked out extremely hard. We call it the Breakfast Club, and it really, really, really paid dividends. That's one reason, honestly, I can say I played long, because during the season, I really went hard to help my body recover. Because if you don't, listen, let me tell you this, man. Your body just isn't meant to take that type of punishment. It's just not. Especially for 16 weeks, plus the preseason and training camp. No, it's just not meant to do it. So you're talking about it. You have big heart and big cahoots. You have to have them.
For sure.
You really do. That's a violent game, man. People don't know how violent football is. It's violent.
To expound on what you were just saying, because some of the things that we start to hear now on the flip side, and I've heard several folks talking about, you know, how the current collective bargaining agreement, which limits teams, they can only hit in practice one day a week, they can only be in pads twice a week, and the second time is really just sort of a walkthrough for the game. But they're saying the reduction in hitting may actually be leading to more injuries because guys aren't in football shape like they were back when you played, right? They're not taking, whether it's not their body isn't used to the hits, or they're not, you know, in whatever football shape, you know, means. But they seem to think that maybe that actually leads to more injuries. What are your thoughts?
No, I disagree with that, because the tackling might suffer. Yes, because nobody tackles anymore. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, nobody. You can't take nobody to the ground, period. And, you know, you get yelled at for taking people to the ground. But they do practice extremely fast. They go full speed, but just not bringing nobody to the ground. I ref the Falcons practice during the week, you know. Like, during the week, I go ref their practices. And I tell you, man, they go wide open. Ain't no half speed, nothing. But you better not tackle. It's just that simple.
So, well, that's good, right? Because that's going to hopefully limit the number of injuries, you know, because that's the thing, right? You know, as a fan of the game, right, it's so frustrating to hear about a star player, or any player really, you know, that's on your team that gets hurt, you know, whether it's in practice or it's in a preseason game, right? A meaningless game, you know, suddenly now you got a guy who blew out a knee, he's torn a hamstring, whatever it is, right? You hear about all of those injuries. I'm curious to get your thought. It's great now that, you know, maybe they're not tackling as much in camp, so maybe we can eliminate some of those injuries from the player and from the fans, you know, that root for that player. But now, you know, thoughts on preseason games. Is there value in having four preseason games, maybe five if you happen to be the unlucky team that has to play the Hall of Fame game?
It is value, too, especially for the younger guys who never played, like the guys who are coming in. Absolutely is value. To the veterans, I just could never get up for the preseason, dude. No matter how hard I tried, I just couldn't do it because I know it don't count.
Right.
I wanted to perform well. You know, you want to perform well, of course, but it's just hard. It really is hard to get up for those games. But younger guys, they definitely need them. Yeah, I think they really need it. Yep, and the older guys, I like how they work their way in. Like today, the Falcons probably played one series, Matt Ryan, two series or whatever. Next week they'll play, you know, two quarters. Then they'll play a little bit more the third preseason game. And the fourth preseason game, they pretty much don't play. So
right.
So they trying to, you know, save the stars, quote unquote stars for the game, because
right. That's
who sell tickets. That's who sell tickets, right?
Right.
You're not trying to go see Joe Smoke. You're trying to go see Julio Jones. You know what I mean?
So,
that's just a joke.
Yeah.
So,
Fred, you know, I'm curious. You know, the game has changed so much, you know, over the last few years. It's a passing league now. We see fewer and fewer teams employing a fullback, the position that you played. Do you think the position will eventually phase completely out, or do you think it's just sort of a cycle and everything is going to come back around, like the value of running backs and fullbacks? Will that come back at some point?
I doubt it.
No?
I doubt it. It's several teams that still have fullbacks too, though. You know, most just about every team has a fullback. It's just they're not as used as much. That's
mm-hmm.
all, you know. Every team has a fullback. But how much they're used, probably not as much, you know. Tampa Bay has one. I know Atlanta has one that they use. The Texans, I think the Texans have one. Most teams that I know have one. But because you still need that fullback to lead through that hole. You still need
mm-hmm.
it. If not, you know, it's hard running without a fullback over and over and over.
Yes,
you get your butt,
I imagine
you
it is.
Because they have seven linemen. You got an eighth guy in the box. Dude. It becomes two free instead of one free. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Help me out one time, right? Running back looking for some help.
You know, come on, fullback. Get in front of me, buddy. I need you.
Fred, one more before we let you go. But you've got a foundation that you've been involved with for a few years, 44 Ways. Talk about the people that you're helping with your foundation.
What we do, man, like, we help, like, underprivileged families in need, you know. We've been doing it. This is my 12th year doing it. It's in Naples, Florida, beautiful Naples, Florida. They give me such great support down there with the Hard Rock Casino, Seminole Casino down there, the Hammock Bay Golf Course, and all those guys. They're really good to me, and we really try to help the less fortunate. But this year, we're going to help my Pop Warner football team out, the Naples Gators, get new uniforms, get new helmets, which I'm a big advocate of, because the stuff they have is I don't know how it passed inspection. I really don't. So
that's sad.
I'm serious. Yeah, it's pretty sad. In rich Naples. And I don't get that, you know what I mean? So
mm-hmm.
I'm a lend my helping hand, man, and get those guys help get those guys back on track, get them new uniforms.
And there you go,
them, man. Nice. Yeah, because they really need it, man. Like when I tell you they really need it, they really need it. So
that's great. Good for you.
Yeah, I'm gonna help them out, man. That's what it's about.
There you go, Fred. How can our listeners stay up to date with all the stuff you're doing, whether that's online or over social media?
I'm on Facebook at Fred McCrary, and I'm on Twitter at Fred McCrary, and on Instagram at Fred McCrary 44. Boom. come follow me. I have some pretty cool stuff on there.
Yes, you do. Yeah, and you're fun, Fred. I tell you what, we have such a great time because the enthusiasm you bring to the segment when you join us is fantastic. We hope you'll come back
and do
it again,
man,
during the season.
I sure will. I definitely will, man. Come check back in with me, and I'd love to come back on, man. You guys are doing a great job, and I'll talk to you guys soon, man.
Thanks all right,
so
Fred.
Much,
take
Fred.
Care. All the best to you and your family, Fred.
Okay, you too, buddy. Thanks, man.
Take care.
That is former Chargers and Falcons fullback Fred McCrary. I tell you, Bob, you know, kudos to him and kudos to the team. And, you know, Lee Hansen is the guy, the inventor of Guardian caps. And we had Lee on the show several years ago, and I recently reached back out to him. He's going to join us here on the show in a couple of weeks and really talk about how Guardian caps have really started to catch on. To Fred's point, some of the major colleges are really jumping on board with this thing. And, you know, Bob, hopefully what we're seeing is, you know, it's the Guardian caps and our friend Doc from Shock Strips, those things, you know, started to catch on in the youth leagues. And we're starting to see them, you know, now more into the high schools. I know one of the teams that my son played against, South Paulding, they used it last year. So hopefully we're going to start to see it, you know, branch out more and more into the high schools. Now we're starting to see it in some of the major colleges. And I hope it's just, you know, a minute before we start seeing it in the NFL, and not just in practice, but in games. To me, there's no reason why we can't have those things in games. You know, I mean, I get that, you know, Rydell wants to have, you know, the Rydell helmet and all of that sort of thing. And there's no reason why you can't have the little Rydell sticker showing from, you know, the front of the Guardian cap. And you can paint the Guardian cap any color you want. You could do the same with the Shock Strips. There's no reason why we can't start seeing it in the NFL. And hopefully it's not just in practice, but in game situations as well.
Well, you make a good point, Chris. The NFL could probably avoid a lot of litigation in the future by doing as much as they can for head safety. And Fred made a great point, Chris, that I'd never really even thought. I probably crossed my mind, but I guess you got to hear it once in a while about kids' necks. You know, we don't think about the kids are still growing and their necks are smaller. And you know how guys like Fred worked on their neck muscles because of what he did. And who better to listen to than a guy that spent so much time in the trenches like he did.
Absolutely.
But he's doing the great stuff, and always he's infectious the way he speaks to us, Chris, and that's why he keeps coming back.
That's right. All right, folks, now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line in his weekly regular time slot is former Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins. Hey, Tony, how you doing tonight, my friend?
Good evening, Tony.
I am doing fantastic. How you guys doing?
Really well. Thank you. So, Tony, I wanted to start off our time with you tonight, kind of taking you back to the late 80s with the Patriots. Curious what it was like when Doug Flutie signed with the team. You know, what was it like playing with Doug, and what was the buzz like when he showed up?
I mean, the buzz was big because, you know, he's from the area and, you know,
right.
He went to Boston College and, you know, the buzz was really big. He actually came back right after the strike season. I think it was during the strike. We had a strike. I can't remember what year it was. But the buzz was fantastic, man. I mean, Doug Flutie's a great guy. He's also came to play in one of my tournaments. Just a great guy. He has a foundation as well with his son that he does and raises a lot of money. I mean, the buzz was fantastic. I mean, you know, I think more fans came out just because he was in a Patriot uniform. Now, I mean, Doug, you know, when you see Doug and you see him face to face, he's probably like 5'11". I think it's probably stats got him at 6'1", but he's not close to being 6'1". He's like 5'11", But a great athlete, a great competitor, that's one thing that I learned about Doug. He loves to compete. He's always been the underdog because, you know, how
yes.
how tall he was. But just a great guy all around.
You know, and, you know, Tony, it's something, you know, that we've wondered about, you know, over the course of the parts of the three seasons that that Doug was with the Patriots, you know, they were 8-5. You guys were 8-5 in his 13 starts. If you added up the Patriots' overall record from 87 to 89 when he was there, right, he finished 22-25. So the team's record with Flutie was 3 games over .500 while they were, you know, 3 games under. With everybody else. So, you know, you got a 6-game swing, if you will, there. So, yet, you know, they let him go in favor of Mark Wilson and Tommy Hodson, who combined to go 0-12 in 1990. Oh, by the way, Steve Grogan was 1-3 when they, in the 4 starts that he had. So it was a sort of a brutal year all the way around for the Patriots. Lost their last 13 games that year. So I'm just curious to get your thought. Why do you think it was everywhere that Doug went, including Buffalo, where he was 21-9, oh, by the way, as a starter, no one believed enough in him to really give him the starting job for very long? It's almost like they didn't believe it. Right? Yeah, okay, he's, you know, 21-9 here at the Bills, and he was 8-5 with the Patriots. It's like, we don't believe it. It's just, they must be doing it somehow with mirrors. We don't like it. It's not sexy enough, the way Doug wins. So they kept letting him go.
Well,
curious to get your thoughts.
You got to understand a thing about Doug. He's a winner, man, and he went to Boston College, and he went to Canada, and he probably, I don't know how many Grey Cups he won up there. And then he played some World Football League, and I think he was on a couple great teams there as well. Everywhere he goes, he wins, and that's
right.
That's one of the things about him. He's a competitive man. He loves to win. He fights. But the thing about him that I always liked about him, that, you know, he's down to earth. He's a big time star. With his name, Heisman Trophy winner, but at the same time, he's a down to earth type of guy. But the thing I really love about him is he loves to compete. He's a winner, man. He just wins everywhere he goes.
Bob, questions for Tony?
Hi, Tony. I want to stay on your teammates back in those early days, because one of the guys, looking over the roster before Tony, and one of the guys that stood out to me, I don't think he's ever gotten the credit he deserves. I know he was a first-round draft pick, but you look at his stats, and they really, really stand out. And that was Stanley Morgan.
Yeah.
I'm looking at his numbers right now, Tony. Between 79 and 81, well over 22 yards per catch. The guy was at 1,000 yards every year. He caught over 500 balls in his career, almost 11,000 yards. And you'd never really hear him among the great receivers of the era or of all time. He was that good. How was he as a teammate? He wasn't a big guy either.
Me and Stanley are still friends today, so that lets you know what type of person he is. He comes to probably every tournament that I have. He's attended. Just a super guy. Should be in the Hall of Fame, we believe. I think his day will come one day that he will get in the Hall of Fame, just because of his numbers that he had. You know, you got to understand too, while he was at New England, and we didn't throw the ball 30 to 40 times a game. And so if he would play with a quarterback like Dan Marino or Dan Fouts or somebody like that, who was throwing the ball 40 times, 50 times a game, you know, his numbers would be crazy. But just a super, super person. One of the nicest guys you ever want to meet. Great, great, great sense of humor. I love being around him. We laugh all the time when we're together, and we're friends to this day. And so just a super guy. And like I said, he should be in the Hall of Fame real soon.
And, Tony, when you were coming in, a guy like Sam Cunningham had been around for a while. And this is a guy, you look back and people think Sam Bam Cunningham was just one of these, headbangers. But he had a 1,000-yard season in 77 and had some other great years where he was 700-800 yards. And we heard him for his touchdowns and everything else. But I just wanted your memories of Sam, who spent his entire career in New England.
I got the opportunity to play 1 year with Sam
right.
When I got there in 81. And, you know, Sam was a legend, man, to me. You know, when I got there, it's like, wow, Sam Cunningham. I'm in the backfield with Sam Cunningham. It's pretty cool, you know. So, but another one of those guys who is just a super, super guy, doesn't play golf, so he don't come out to the golf tournaments at all. But just a super, super human being. He's living out in California, just loving the life out there, man. But Sam, you know, he was a fullback. You know, how many 1,000-yard fullbacks do you have? that you don't hear that at all. But Sam was a great athlete, super, super guy on and off the field. So, man, Sam was he's a legend up in New England, without a doubt.
Yep.
And Tony, you know, because kind of flash forward now to the Patriots, you know, this season, I got to believe that they're going to be relying very heavily on their current, you know, core of running backs during the first four games of the season with, you know, Brady being out and serving his suspension. Curious to get your thoughts on the current Patriots running backs, like Garrett Blunt, Brandon Bolden, Deion Lewis, James White. What have you seen from those guys?
I think the one that you're going to have to look out for is Deion Lewis. I think Deion is just an all-around back. He can run the ball out of the backfield. He can catch the ball out of the backfield. He's even a good blocker in pass protection. And being as small as he is, I think Deion is going to be the one that's going to stand out in those first four games. But, you know, Belichick is going to find a way to win. you better believe that. He's going to find a way to win some of those games while Brady is out. And, you know, Gronk, you know, we got a lot of good players around our young quarterback. And so I think we'll be fine. I think we'll be really fine for the first four games. I actually see us being 3-1. If we come out of that, those first four games 3-1, man, it's going to be hell for the rest of the league when Brady comes back. Because, you know, when he comes back, he's going to come back with a vengeance. He doesn't think he got a fair deal with this. And a lot of people, of course, are New England fans don't think he got a fair deal with it as well. But, you know, it is what it is. And like I said, we probably have the best coach to coach the game right now to deal with the situation at hand. And one thing that Belichick does, he wins for what he has, and you're going to see it again these first four games. So I'm you know, really looking forward to see what he does tonight. You know, and I know he's probably not going to play the whole game, but I'm pretty sure he's going to get a lot of reps in tonight. And I think the kid is pretty decent. And you know, one of the things that I know for a fact, and if he's smart, all he has to do is just watch Brady and, you know, keep doing what Brady does. And if he has the work ethic, I don't know if he does or not, but if he does have that work ethic like Brady does, he'll be fine for those first few games. And Belichick's going to protect him. They're going to run the ball, throw some short passes, and get him in a routine where he's not going to hurt the team at all trying to go downfield. So we'll be okay. 3-1. 3-1, watch.
All right.
That's my prediction.
All right. Well, you know, and we got, you know, we're right around the corner from this year's prognostication. So we know you're the champ from last year. So 3-1, we got to say you're probably going to be right.
By the way, who won last year?
Yeah, that was you that won last year. So, you know, that's what I'm saying. Your 3-1 has credibility.
It was me?
That was you. Yes.
I think by one game, Tony. One game.
That's right. Only one game.
That's all that matters, man. Just one game, baby.
Right.
So, Tony, I want to expound on something that you alluded to a moment ago, right? The Patriots have been vying, you know, for a Super Bowl, you know, almost every year since Bill Belichick took over the team back in 2000. And we all know, you know, how great Tom Brady is, like you mentioned there, you know, but, you know, having a great quarterback isn't nearly enough, right? If it was, Dan Marino would have a few rings, you know, right now for his fingers.
Right,
so
right,
I'm curious
right.
to get you, what allows the Patriots, we know Belichick is sort of an evil genius, but what do you think it is that allows them to be so successful year in and year out?
I think it's balance. I think if you look at the team, it's just a balance. We didn't have we didn't have a real good running game. Well, actually, we didn't have a running game at all last year. But, you know, Belichick finds a way to win games. And, you know, last year I think our defense played very well in a lot of games. You know, our offensive line was beaten up a whole lot, but, you know, Brady took a lot of hits last year. But I think the whole thing is just balance. You know, you go into a game with a game plan. And you know, a lot of people don't look into the game plan, and that's what Belichick is a genius at. It's the game planning for each and every game. Every game is going to be different. I think there was a couple of games where Tom was the leading rusher for the game, and that's crazy
yeah.
for you when your quarterback's the leading rusher and you win the game. So, but it's just a balance. It's just a balance, but I think the biggest thing. Is your game plan for each team, how they scout each team, how they go over different players and their good and their bad things that they can do to a team and to a player. And I think that's the genius of Belichick is the game planning for each game, and that's why every year since he's been. Been there, you know. We've always been in every game. It's a dogfight sometimes, but you know we got a chance to win. And of course, when you got a quarterback like Tom, you always got a chance to win a game. So, but to me, the big thing is the game plan.
Tony, before we let you go, remind our listeners one more time: how can they keep up to date with all the great things that you are doing for kids, and you know, follow you online over social media and your wonderful foundation?
TonyCollinsFoundation.com and TonyCollinsProjects.com. You can follow me on Facebook. We're doing some great things up in the Boston area, down here in North Carolina, and also in my hometown in upstate New York, a little great hometown of Pinyan. Man, we're just loving what's going on now. We're helping kids get into school, and just trying to give back. I mean, that's you know that's what you guys do. I love your show. I love the guys that you have bringing in your show. I think pretty much every guy that you have that comes on your show has like some type of foundation that are doing great things. And that's one of the things that we want to get out more. We have so many guys that are doing great things. But a lot of people see all the bad that's going on with, you know, two or three guys when they make some mistakes and they blow that up. But they never blow up the great things that these guys are doing all over
that's
the country.
Right.
And I really really appreciate what you guys do to bring these guys on for them to tell their story and tell what they're doing in their area, in their hometown, in the city that they live in. And we're just giving back, man. One of the things that we know for a fact is that we were fortunate. God gave us ability to play a sport that we love, and we had the opportunity to live our dream, and now we just want to help other kids live their dreams as well.
That's fantastic stuff, Tony. We can't thank you enough, A, for being a part of the show every single week, and B, for the great things that you're doing to help kids get through college and the great things you're doing with your foundation. Thank you very much for both, my friend.
I can't wait till the season starts, man. It's right around the corner now. I'm getting football fever. I can't wait till we start this prediction thing. Come on, what we got? What 2 or 3 weeks left?
We got to get through the 4 weeks of preseason. But yeah, we're getting close.
You had to remind him, Chris. You had to remind him.
That's right. All right, Tony. Have a great week, my friend. We look forward to catching up with you again next week. In between now and then, all the best to you and your family.
Same to you guys. Have a great night.
Good night.
All right, take care, Tony. That is former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins with us every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Always one of the best segments of the show, Bob.
Oh, always a pleasure. And we go in different directions with him, and we never skip a beat. And the positivity is always there, and he always brings it up.
That's right. All right, folks, we're going to get to our next guest, JR Redmond, here on Thursday Night Tailgate. We're going to do that on the other side of these words from our friends over at the French Lick Resort.
This is the time to play legendary golf at French Lick Resort. Book one of our money-saving packages, like the Hall of Fame package, and play our Pete Dye and Donald Ross courses. Stay in historic luxury at our French Lick or West Baden Springs hotels. Relax in our spas. Dine in our restaurants. Have some gaming fun in the casino. Or just rock on our rambling verandas like they did 100 years ago. Go online to FrenchLick.com and book your legendary golf getaway now at French Lick Resort.
Hi, this is former Rams QB Jim Everett. and you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate, a.k.a. TNT. And it's explosive in here with my buddies, the hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. And we're listening to all this on the Armed Forces Radio Network. So take it away, Ben.
And now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is J.R. Redmond. Let me remind you about J.R.'s background. He's from L.A., played his college ball at Arizona State, where he still ranks third all-time on their rushing list with over 3,200 yards, and he averaged 5.3 yards per carry. He was a part of the 1996 team with Jake Plummer and Pat Tillman that went undefeated in the regular season, lost a heartbreaker to Ohio State in the Rose Bowl. He was a third-round draft pick by the New England Patriots in 2000, played in the NFL from 2000 to 2005 with the Patriots, Raiders, and Cardinals. Over that time, he accounted for just over 1,400 all-purpose yards, and we're very honored that he is back with us again tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, JR, Chris and Bob here. Thanks for coming back on the show.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks. Thanks for having me.
So, JR, I wanted to start our time tonight with you by getting your thoughts on your alma mater, Arizona State. Struggled a little bit last season, finishing 6-7 after having two really good seasons back-to-back in 2013 and 14. Your thoughts on where the program is right now?
I think it's going in the right direction. They should be successful. Just like everyone else, you know, everyone's working hard to try and get it done, and I don't see the any reason why they won't be able to get it done this year. Most times it isn't it's just guys getting in the way of themselves sometimes, missing a play here or there, but it doesn't seem to be any real, you know, major problem, so I think everything should be good.
You know, JR, last year collectively their running backs rushed for over 2,000 yards. They were led by DeMario Richard, who had just over 1,100 rushing yards. I'm curious, do you have an opportunity to talk with or watch DeMario Richard? Your thoughts on what you've seen from him?
He's an explosive kid, good back, low center of gravity, he makes plays. Have an opportunity to watch him several times. I think he's a good player. I think he's a real good player. I think he's solid.
And, JR, now you've got an opportunity to work with and train kids. And when you get the opportunity to spend some time with young players, what are some of the life lessons that you get to share with them?
Really just the whole experience. Getting the opportunity to experience all of the emotions, the ups, the downs, not being too high when things are high and not being too low when things are low, and just knowing that it's not always going to be easy. There's going to be obstacles.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be barriers and things of that nature, and you have to do the best you can.
Bob, questions for JR?
Sure. JR, looking at your college stats at Arizona State, you improved every year in that last year. You were about 1,200 yards, an incredible season. Just wondering, JR, come draft day, your expectations, were you expecting to stay close to home, and what was your thoughts when you were going 3,000 miles away to New England?
No, I'll being a lifelong goal and a dream, you know, it didn't matter. And when I got to New England, when I heard I was going to New England, I honestly, at first, I was like, where is that at? so I did, you know, actually, I did have an opportunity for the draft. Couple
different
places I did the opportunity to visit.
And how about that?
I just was happy to be somewhere.
Yeah. And I want to ask you, JR, about that first training camp in New England. Belichick before he was really, really Belichick. But how was the training camp, the rigors of it? Bring us back to 2000.
The only thing I can remember about 2000 training camp is practice. And practice. That's the only thing that I can remember. And for the most part, everything was really new to me in terms of how to approach studying and preparing. All of those things were getting educated on that process. The biggest thing with Belichick, I'd say, definitely is preparation. Preparation is everything.
And I was sort of looking over some of your social media feeds. You recently posted a note about the reception that you still get from Patriots fans when you either go into training camp or you go back for a game. Talk about what it's like for you and the reception that Patriots fans still give you.
Man, it's amazing. You know, it's been obviously a while. 15 years or so. It's been a while. Every time I get the opportunity to come back there, it feels like, you know, it really feels like it was just yesterday. And the people there, the fans are awesome. They know who you are. They really know. It doesn't matter what year you came through there. There are guys that I have an opportunity to see that were there, 15, 20 years before me. And as soon as they walk up, you hear the fans yelling their name. And not only yelling their name, saying, "I remember when you did this, and I remember when you did that." And, it's a real good feeling.
And, JR, I got to believe it's, when you're kind of looking back over, the course of your career, one of the things that sticks out has got to be, the pivotal role that you played in the Patriots Raiders AFC Championship game when the tuck rule came into play in the snow up there in Foxborough. But I'm curious to get your thoughts. You were such a big part of the final drive that ended up winning the game for the Patriots. What do you remember about that last drive?
For the snowball?
Yes.
I remember a couple things about it. One, I thought game was over. That was the first thing. I thought the game was over. And it was just amazing to even get opportunity to go back on the field. I didn't know anything about the rules. I just remember guys making plays. It didn't matter what play was called or which way the ball was going. Everybody found a way to get the job done. And that's the basic. Most of that, everybody touched the ball. The ball went in everyone's hands, and everybody made a play to help Billy
Gill. JR, before we let you go, let our listeners know, how can they stay up to date with all the things that you're doing currently, whether it's online or over social media somewhere?
You can just friend me. On Facebook, JR Redmond. If you want to check out the things I'm doing, just working with youth training, letting them know the importance of just getting after it, getting your education, making sure you're educated on everything you're doing, especially if you're going to play football, making sure that you're learning how to do things the right way so that you can be safe, you can protect yourself.
There you go.
And being a good person, being a giver more than you are a taker.
Great stuff. JR, thank you so much for taking time out of your night to come back on the show. We hope you'll come back and do it again sometime. Love to stay in touch and get your insights during the season on your thoughts on the Sun Devils and the Patriots.
Okay, thank you.
All right, take care, JR. That is former Patriots running back J.R. Redmond. And I tell you what, Bob, you know, his former alma mater, I guess it still is alma mater, right? The Arizona Sun Devils, a team, you know, really strong in 2013 and 14. It's going to be interesting to see how DeMario Richard, you know, plays this upcoming season and if they can turn it around. You know, being right now out here in Phoenix, you know, people, you know, talking about whether it's the University of Arizona, Arizona State, Sun Devil stuff everywhere out here.
Yeah, it's, you know, I've been out to Phoenix once, Chris, and, you know, this is before baseball really, really even caught on, and it's always been a football place. And then, you know, after the whole Pat Tillman thing, football just, it's big there, and they look at it at every level, and now it'll be interesting to see how these teams do. It's such a rivalry. People downplay it, but it's big. Arizona, Arizona State. Unless you're out there, you won't know it.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. All right, folks, coming up here in hour number two on Thursday Night Tailgate, sponsored by Kyven Foods, Coastal Orthopedics, the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory, and the French Lick Resort. We're going to have former Dolphins, Eagles, and Chargers running back Ronnie Brown and Cowboys Hall of Fame defensive tackle Bob Lilly. Ronnie Brown is hanging on the line. We're going to get to him on the other side of this station identification.
This is Reggie Kelly, former Cincinnati Bengals and Atlanta Falcons tight end, and you're listening to TNT, Thursday Night Tailgate. Brace yourself for the explosion.
And now back with us and making his fourth appearance on the Kyven Foods guest line is Ronnie Brown. Let me remind you about Ronnie's background. He's from Rome, Georgia, played his high school ball just a couple of exits north of where I live typically, in Cartersville High School, which is about 45 minutes north of Atlanta. Played his college ball at Auburn, where he was a two-time All-SEC running back and the Citrus Bowl MVP back in 2003. He was a first-round draft pick, the number two overall selection by the Miami Dolphins in 2005, and he played in the NFL from 05 to 2014 with the Dolphins, Eagles, Chargers, and Texans. Over the course of his career, he rushed for just under 5,400 yards and had just under 2,000 receiving yards, and he scored 40 touchdowns. He was selected to the Pro Bowl in 2008, and we are very excited he is back with us again tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Ronnie, Chris, and Bob here. Thanks for coming back on the show.
Thanks, Ronnie.
Hey, appreciate you guys for having me.
So, Ronnie, like I said, as a guy who lives in the Marietta, Kennesaw area, and I know a lot of folks who are still shaking their heads when I mention your name because they just can't understand how Georgia and Georgia Tech let you get away to play your college ball at Auburn. Talk about how did that happen?
Well, you know, one, I wanted to play in the SEC, so that was number one. So that's one of the reasons I didn't go to Tech. And two was just for the reason that, you know, I grew up a Georgia fan. Garrison Hurst was one of my favorite guys growing up. But they recruited another kid, Musa Smith, out of New Jersey. So me having to make a business decision, I was like, well, if they're getting this kid from New Jersey, it's going to be a chance that one of us, you know, has to make a position change or something. And I figured, you know, he's coming from that far away, it would probably be him. So I narrowed my choices down to Tennessee and Auburn. And I took an official visit to Auburn University and just fell in love with it. You know, I'm from Cartersville, Georgia. It's a small town. So when I went to Auburn, it was pretty much simply the same thing. A small town environment and not really much there but the school. So it was fitting for myself.
And Ronnie, you know, Auburn had a bit of a tough season last year. They finished at the bottom of the SEC West, 7-6 overall, taking a couple of steps backwards over the last couple of years since finishing 12-2 in Gus Malzahn's, you know, first season back in 2013. Curious to get, how do you feel about, you know, the program and where they're headed right now?
Well, I like what they're doing. We've got a few new hires, and it's a new season, you know, with new opportunities. And with that in mind, you know, you never know what to expect. We expect big things from Gus and his offense. Rhett Lashley's been doing a great job, so I look forward to him, you know, making a lot of play calls. And, you know, we've got some receivers there, some playmakers. Unfortunately, you know, running back situation, we've had a few of those. But I think, you know, when you have adversity, it draws your team together, and that's what makes guys, you know, come together a little bit more because you have to lean on more people. So I think that's going to be helpful. But then at the same time, you know, it's the SEC, so you never know what to expect. But, you know, we do expect big things.
curious, Ronnie, you know, during your time there at Auburn, you guys only lost to Alabama once. What's it like being, you know, being a star player, being the player that you were, and just, you know, for the team in general, what's it like when you come back to campus after having, you know, won an Iron Bowl?
Well, you know, it's funny because, you know, being from Georgia, I didn't really understand the magnitude of that game before I got to Auburn University. And when I got there and the week of that game, you know, hearing about it, it's like Auburn, Alabama, and you're hearing about it and everybody's building it up. But to be a part of it and, you know, be from Georgia, you know, for me, it was Georgia. I wanted to beat Georgia because I'm from Georgia, had a lot of friends that played at Georgia, went to Georgia. So that was my thing. But until you experience that atmosphere, you know, there's nothing like it. The way the state's divided, you either one or the other, and hopefully more times than not, it's our school and not the other school. But once you experience it and you realize the magnitude of that game and the weight that it carries for that whole year after, you know, it just produces that, you know, that competitive edge and competitive nature in you that you want to win.
Bob, questions for Ronnie?
Yeah, Ronnie, it's great to speak with you again. And I noticed going over your college stats that they started throwing you the ball at Auburn a lot more during your final season, which would ultimately carry on to the NFL because your first few seasons in Miami, you caught the ball a lot. Was there a reason why, Ronnie, they started throwing you the ball in your senior year, which is that the offense that year?
Oh, absolutely. We had a guy named Carnell Williams that was a big reason for that. And, you know, for me, it was I wanted to get on the field. And, you know, for myself, it was just by any means possible. And the best way for me was, you know, obviously Cadillac and everybody knew what he was expected to do, you know, Heisman hopeful and all these things. So for me to get on the field, I had to kind of expand my role in the offense. And that was one of the things I was comfortable doing. And luckily we got a, you know, Al Borges is a new offensive coordinator that year that, you know, expressed that he wanted to get me involved in the passing game, which was fitting.
And, Ronnie, those first 2 years in the NFL under Nick Saban, many people, they think of Nick Saban as one of those guys that probably should have never left the college ranks, is strictly a college coach, but you had two of your best seasons under him. Your thoughts about Nick Saban as a pro coach?
Well, you know, I was comfortable with that change because coming out of college, going back into a college, not so much atmosphere, but routine, you know,
right,
with the way that we did practice and, you know, all those things, I was comfortable with that. I didn't know any difference. Whereas the veterans, you know, they were a little bit different, used to a different schedule and doing things a little bit more of their routine that they had become accustomed to. So I didn't know any difference. So for me, you know, I was able to fall in line and it made it the transition easier. And, you know, we got along very well. And I think, you know, he and I saw eye to eye. And I knew if I came in and did what I was supposed to do in terms of being where I needed to be, when I needed to be there and, you know, doing the things that didn't take talent, you know, we were good. So, and then on the other end of it, competing and giving everything I had. And, you know, I think that's what ultimately gains the respect of guys like Nick Saban or people who are successful in what they do. You know, they have a routine and the way they go about things and what they expect.
Ronnie, as a Steelers fan, I'm counting on one of your former Auburn wide receivers, Sammy Coates, this season. Any thoughts on how good you think Sammy might be?
Well, I think he's going to do tremendous. From what some of the things I've been reading about how he's performed in camp, you know, he's coming into his own. You know, I think athletically, I think he's as talented as some of the guys that, you know, you see around the league. It's just, you know, finding your niche and becoming comfortable in your role with that respective team. And I think, you know, he's had a year to grow, to learn the system. And I think, you know, this is the year that I think your most growth in the NFL happens usually between your first and second year. And I think, you know, his expectations for himself after sitting out and not really getting a lot of playing time is to play. And that's what you want. You want a guy who wants to be on the field, although they do have a lot of talented receivers, but you have to expect to want to be out there and be a part of what's going on.
You know, Ronnie, a lot of people in the media are touting that another Auburn alum, Cam Newton, is the best player in the NFL right now. Is he?
You know, it's hard to say. The best player in the NFL, there's so many guys out there. The most athletic quarterback, I'd be willing to bet that. You know, but in terms of the best player, it varies because it just depends on what position you like. You know, he does a lot of great things from the quarterback positions and, you know, God-given talent that he's been given. You know, he's able to, you know, do some things that's not expected from that that quarterback position. We've only seen a couple other guys that are able to do some of the things he does with his legs. And, you know, so, I mean, I don't know if I'd go out and say the best player in the NFL because I look at things a little differently, but one of the most athletic guys, I'd be willing to bet that.
And Ronnie, for a guy who spent as many years in the league as you have, if you had an opportunity to, you know, sit down with Roger Goodell and give him some advice or some feedback on what you've seen and what it was like in playing the league for you, what would you tell him?
It was a great experience. Nothing that I could dream of myself. Growing up wanting to be an NFL player and to get that experience, you know, to be able to have that experience, it was a blessing. But at the same time, you know, there were some things later on in my career that I didn't like so much, you know, from the business side of it, you know, just in terms of, you know, some ideas about changing the game in terms of, you know, taking away preseason games and, you know, trying to add another regular season game. I think that's taking away opportunities for some of the guys that, you know, aren't drafted and have to make their way and grind their way onto a team. And, you know, we started a preseason, you know, today, and to get some guys who weren't drafted and to give them the opportunities and start on special teams and those guys who develop in the, you know, key position players, you know, you're taking those opportunities away from guys. So, you know, from the business aspect, you know, there were a couple things I changed. Just comparative to other sports, baseball, i.e. basketball, and having the money be guaranteed. You know, I think creating that, because the risk versus the reward, you know, if you are good and you're lucky and you have to be all those things to get the big paycheck, you know, you still may not make it through the whole contract. You know, you get what you get in terms of guaranteed bonuses, but outside of that, you know, nothing is pretty much guaranteed. So it's all based on year to year pretty much. So there were a few things that I would change, but just the whole experience, I loved it.
We're talking to Ronnie Brown here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Bob, one more for Ronnie before we let him go.
Yeah, sure, Ronnie. You notice that you sandwiched in that career in Miami and San Diego. There was a year in Philadelphia there. And I was just going to ask you, you know, for a guy that played in the warm weather for most of his career, here you go to Philadelphia that one year. Andy Reid, some very talented players, a la your LeSean McCoy and Michael Vick, et cetera. But a town that boos Santa Claus. Ronnie, tell me what that experience was like.
You know, that was one of the roughest years I've ever had in terms of playing sport. And it wasn't because it was cold weather. You know, in college we played a couple games in Miami. We go up to New England. You know, we played in Kansas City one year, negative 19 wind chill. So that didn't really affect me. It was, you know, the free agency process and then going to a new city where I wasn't as comfortable and, you know, my expectations going in, wanting to play football. And, you know, that's all I pretty much wanted to do. And then when I get there, you know, my role, you know, my understanding of my role when I get there, it wasn't, you know, to do that. So I was kind of outside of my comfort zone. I didn't fit in their offense that well. You know, I was more of a zone runner downhill. Everything they did was pretty much outside stretch, outside zone plays, you know, for, you know, LeSean McCoy. So, you know, I was thinking short yardage and stuff like that, but their short yardage goal line package wasn't really fitting to my style. So, you know, it was tough because I wasn't able to be in my comfort zone. You know, I was in Philadelphia. You know, it was my first season there, trying to get, you know, close with all the guys, trying to become accustomed with a routine, how I did things, what time I wanted to arrive at the facility, you know, and those type things, along with not playing. And, you know, so it was just frustrating. And that was a year that I kind of really wanted to kind of give up football. And I was at a point where it wasn't as fun for me, you know, so it made it tough to go to work. So that was the toughest year I had, but it was a learning process. And I appreciate it now because I had to go through that and it prepared me to go to San Diego, which things got better. And I enjoyed, and I think I enjoyed the process more, and, you know, just being able to have the opportunity. It made all of that stuff come back and not take anything for granted.
We've got our next guest, Bob Lilly, hanging on the line. We're going to get to Bob in just one moment. Ronnie, before we let you go, I got to know, are you staying in football shape just in case the phone rings, like, say, my Steelers need a running back if Le'Veon Bell gets suspended?
You know what? I'm not. I think I'm past that. I'm looking forward to see what's next in my life. I like to be in football shape, just not for football. And, you know, I just looking forward to, you know, what's my – I've had a chance to fulfill my passion. Now I'm searching for my purpose and, you know, why I'm here and how I can make a difference for someone else. So, you know, if I can do that, then everything's good. And just to see what else I'm good at. You know, I played football all my life. And to venture out into a new world, you know, I kind of tell my wife that it's – you know, I'm in the process of seeing what I want to be when I grow up at 35 years old. So, you know, it's exciting, but it's a different experience.
Well, you know, we're always here for you, Ronnie. If there's anything we can do to help promote what you're doing, whatever it is you decide to do, we hope you'll come back and join us here on the show and talk about it and let us, you know, do what we can to help promote what you're doing. We think highly of you. You've been so generous and kind to us to be, you know, on the show now four times. So, and we hope you'll come back during the season and share more of your stories and insights with us, because you're always so fantastic as we have you here.
Will do. I appreciate the opportunity. I enjoy being on, and, you know, hope you guys have a great evening. I look forward to coming back on.
All right, Ronnie.
Thank you.
Take care. All the best to your new family. We'll catch up with you again real soon.
All right.
Good night.
That is former Auburn, Miami Dolphins, Eagles, Chargers running back. What a great player Ronnie Brown was. And Bob, it's always a privilege for us to get the opportunity to talk to Ronnie, and what a great versatile back he was. I think everyone would agree. You know, not only could he run the ball and catch the ball in the Wildcat offense, sort of was the guy that, you know, as we talk about the Wildcat, you always picture Ronnie Brown being the quarterback leading that Wildcat offense in Miami.
Very, very true, Chris. And you said the word versatile. He was that, and big enough where he could do a lot of things. 230 pounds, and carried it very well. And is very thankful for his time in the NFL. And like most of our guests, Chris, he's looking for how to improve others' lives. And that's why we keep inviting him back. He's great.
Absolutely right. Yep, absolutely right. All right, before we get to our next guest, Bob Lilly, I want to give a shout-out to our good friend Renee Schull at Career Engagement Institute. Folks, if you're upside down in your career, what do we mean by that? You're ready to move on in your career. Go to careerengagement.institute to see how Renee can help you. You heard Toy Cook not that long ago singing Renee's praises. And if you work with Renee for 2 minutes, you're going to understand exactly why Toy did that and why we do that every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Because we all want to work with someone that we can trust and actually has our best interests at heart. You know how rare it is to find somebody like that. Well, you're not going to find someone who fits that description any better than Renee Schull. She is smart. She is creative, very talented, the kind of person you want to work with and have working for you. She's been doing some great things for some of our guests who have been in transition from being pro athletes and are now getting into the job market. Folks, I'm telling you, Renee is just the very best. There isn't a better way to describe her than that. If you're an athlete or anyone in the job market, do yourself a favor and reach out to Renee. You're going to be so very glad that you did. Go to careerengagement.institute online, careerengagement.institute, or give her a follow on Twitter at Integrated Play. All right, now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Cowboys Hall of Fame defensive tackle Bob Lilly. Let me give you some more background on Bob. He is from Throckmorton, Texas, which is northwest of Dallas, sort of in between Dallas and Lubbock. But his family moved to Pendleton, Oregon, his senior year of high school. That year, he was named All-State in both football and basketball. He played his college ball at TCU, where he led the Horned Frogs to the 1958 and 1959 Southwest Conference Championships, and he was named All-Southwest Conference twice and in a consensus All-American back in 1960. 2006, he was inducted into the East-West Shrine Game Hall of Fame, and in 1980, he was inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame. He was the Cowboys' first ever draft pick in 1961, and he was a part of their Super Bowl VI championship team in 1971. He was an 11-time Pro Bowler. He was named to the NFL's 75th anniversary team and to the all-decade teams for both the 1960s and 1970s. He was inducted, the first inductee into the Cowboys Ring of Honor at Cowboys Stadium. He was also inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 1980. In 1999, the Sporting News ranked him the number 10 on their list of the 100 greatest football players of all time. And we are so very honored that he is with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Bob, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari here. Thank you for joining us.
Hi, Bob.
Thank you. Thank you, Chris and Bob. It's good to be on your program.
So, Bob, I'd like to start, you know, with your decision to, you know, play your college ball at TCU, particularly after you'd kind of moved up to Oregon. Was it sort of a case of, you know, you can take the boy out of Texas, but you can't take Texas out of the boy?
Well, sort of, but really, my dad was the one. He was a big promoter of me playing football. Really, my dad was a big guy, really, really talented and really athletic talented. But he had a broken femur when he was about 13 years old, and they put a plate in there, but they didn't stretch the legs back then, and he had about an inch and a half difference in, you know, in the length of his legs. So he never really could participate. He played golf and he did what he could, but he loved football, and his hero was Sammy Ball, who played at TCU as well. And so anyway, Dad made friends with the people there. We used to go to games when I was a kid at TCU, and that's the only college football games I'd ever been to live. And we went pretty often from the time I was probably third grade, all the way through the time we went to Oregon. And, of course, when I was in Oregon and I had a good senior year, and it was really it was a real blessing in a way, because we had a large drought in Texas during that time. We were kind of – we farmed and custom farmed, and we did oil field work. And, anyway, the oil prices went down, and everything happened at once. And so we called around to our kin folks, and my mother had an uncle named George up in the Pendleton area, and a first cousin named Paul. They got Dad a job, and so we go up there, and I'm thinking, well, at least I don't have to haul hay anymore. And it turns out my mother's uncle George had a 640-acre alfalfa farm, irrigated, which the next morning after we got unpacked, my dad said, it's time to get up at 5:30, and we got up as usual, and put your work clothes on. I said, where are we going, Dad? And he said, well, Uncle George has got 200 acres of hay on the field that I'm fixing to bale, and you're going to haul. So anyway, that was my first day in Oregon, and
wow,
kind of interesting. But
yeah,
it was a great experience. I visited. I did get to go visit, Oregon State, and Washington State, and I got invited to visit some California schools and Idaho, and maybe anyway, two or three other schools, and I loved all of them. But I had only been to college football games at TCU, and it was so. I went back. I drove all the way down to back to Texas from Oregon in June with a teammate of mine, and we went down, and he tried out for a basketball scholarship. And of course, they had offered me a scholarship, and they did. I signed my contract with them, and the fellow I was with also qualified. They said, yes, you can definitely have a scholarship, but you will have to pay your first year at TCU, which he couldn't afford. So he went on back to – we both went back to Oregon together, and he went to college and became the principal. He was a basketball coach and principal and so forth in Pendleton. But – anyway, it was a lovely experience. I can tell you, I enjoyed that 1 year immensely, getting to go trout fishing and getting to go out and see the mountains and the streams and all that was just a blessing for somebody that had been through a drought for 6 years.
And Bob, I'm curious, you know, since, you know, neither the Cowboys nor the Dallas Texans or even the Houston Oilers existed when you were a kid, did you have a favorite team growing up that played in the NFL?
Well, you know, we We let the I think the year I was in Pendleton, actually it was in college, but we watched. I did get to watch. We had a TV in 1956, and that was just before we moved up there. We got two channels. We didn't have cable, but we got one channel out of Abilene, Texas, one out of Wichita Falls, and we had a big antenna. And so I did get to start watching a little bit of pro football. But I guess a significant game in my memory banks is the game between New York and Baltimore. And I had watched Baltimore two or three times, and they had Gino Marchetti, and they had Johnny Unitas, and they had Alan Ameche, and they had, you know, Big Daddy and all these guys. And I kind of had a real love for them, and they won the game against New York in the playoffs. And I really always felt that game is kind of put football on the map. That was a big game, and many, many people watched it, and it was a great game. And so I just always sort of liked Baltimore when I was a kid, you know, when I was growing up. And I never thought about becoming a team in Dallas, nor, you know, the Texans also became a team at the same time. They were both in Dallas at the same time. And, of course, the Texans are now the Chiefs. But anyway, that was my favorite at that time.
Bob, questions for Bob?
Hey, thanks for giving us some time. It's a true honor, Bob. And I'm looking at your rookie year. When you came into the league, there was no way you could tell yourself that you were going to play for one coach for the next 14 years or so. First impressions you got of Tom Landry, and how instrumental was he in you becoming a Hall of Famer?
Well, I didn't know much about the Cowboys because they had only been there 1 year, and
right,
I didn't take the newspaper. I read the secondhand news, but the Cowboys didn't do real well the first year. I think they tied one game. But anyway, everything I read about Coach Landry was very positive, and I knew that he had been in New York coaching as the head defensive coach, they called him, and he coached along with Vince Lombardi, who was the head offensive coach. And I did meet him. I got to meet him, and obviously I was drafted by the Cowboys. And so I don't think I watched any of their games in person, but I did get to see a couple or three of them on TV. But I had, I asked my coach at TCU, and his name was Abe Martin. He was a great coach back in those years, and I said, Coach, I don't know what to do. And he said, well, I know both owners. You know, I know their families, and they're both fine. They're all fine people. But he said, you know, the Texans came here once before, and that was Baltimore. That was the team I loved. I didn't know that. He said, and they didn't last but a couple of years, and they went to Baltimore. And he said, so I don't know about the new leagues. He said, we've seen a lot of them come and go. And he said, I think I would go with the NFL since you're drafted by both of them if everything's pretty even. And so that's probably the main reason I went with the Cowboys. A lot of my buddies went with the Texans. They were drafting a lot of Southwest Conference players, and that's back in those days, that's what we had here in Texas was Southwest Conference, including Arkansas was also in it. And so I was very happy with going to TCU. We did have good teams and had great teammates and great players, and we had good luck. Our last year, my senior year, we had some players get hurt early in the year and didn't do too well. We were 4-4-2, but I think we only gave up eight and a half points a game. So we just didn't quite put enough points on the board. But Coach Landry, getting back to what you said, I met him and after I was drafted, and ultimately went to training camp up in actually Northfield, Minnesota, the first year, and that was quite an experience for me. I was really there were maybe 13 rookies or 14 rookies. There were more than that going to camp, but we had 4 weeks of two-a-days. And my roommate in college was Larry Dawson, who was from Stinnett. Larry could have made the starting lineup as a strong safety, but he wanted to be a rodeo cowboy, not a cowboy, but a rodeo cowboy. And he did that. He did it for 20 or 25 years, and I think he was always in the top 10 in bulldogging. But anyway, I think you asked a question a while ago, how was it? And it was way above where I had been, let's put it that way. Coach Landry had a vast experience, vast knowledge of the game, and he was a very brilliant person. And he had high expectations from all of us. So it was a pretty tough first year for me.
And, Bob, I think of the entire Dallas franchise, especially during your career, and synonymous with legends like Landry and yourself is Tex Schramm, the architect of all this. People forget that he was around for about 30 years active as a president and general manager. Just wanted to get your opinion on your dealings with him and the greatness of Tex Schramm.
Well, first of all, Tex was – he was an innovator. And there's no question about mm-hmm. that. He was a great innovator of football. He made a great decision in hiring Coach Landry. And he had been in football out in Los Angeles when he came to Dallas. But he was a tough man to deal with. I mean, I think they offered me 9.5, Gil Brandt. And then they finally, I think I signed for 11.5 before I started that year. So every time I negotiated with him, I would get in my prayer closet because I didn't know how to deal with him. I mean, he was really tough, but he was one of the most innovative people I've ever been around. He was very, very pro Cowboys, and he loved the team. And he really would do anything. Looking back on it, I don't think we had a lot of money. I mean, Clint Merkson was a rich man, but. I don't think we made a whole lot of money the first few years. And so I never look back on that as a bad experience. I always look back on that as a great experience because it taught me how to be frugal as far as living. It taught me how to build. Coach Landry was so good at teaching that he not only taught us about football, but he taught us about setting goals and accomplishing goals. And we had a blackboard that was probably 20 yards, probably 15 yards wide. That was huge, and they had the black ink that they could mark off the board, and they had red. They had no blue. It was blue and red. The blue was good. The red was bad. And so we had for every individual, all the way up to your particular. If you were a defensive lineman, then your defense. And it had everything. It was like score points. Our goal was always to score 21 or more points and to hold our opposition to 17 or less. And our goal was always to keep a certain amount of the pass receptions to 12 yards or less per catch. It was always our goal to keep the opposition from averaging more than 3 yards per carry. And I'll tell you what, it was amazing. We would get into the red, and he would stay out there with us after practice for 30 minutes, and we would all go through the whole thing. Everybody had to go through it. And he would teach us who we were playing, what we were doing wrong. And anyway, it was just amazing that within 2 weeks we could correct all that, and it would be going up instead of going down. So it taught me a lot about not just football, but about life and about how to set goals and how to accomplish goals. Plus, they drafted the best player available, and they had a lot of Tex and Coach Landry's ideas that, like drafting the best player available, all kinds of. I mean, it was. The cheerleaders, I think we were maybe the first ones to have the cheerleaders. We had all kinds of innovations, and both Coach Landry and Tex Schramm were extremely innovative. And that's, I think that's why the Cowboys ultimately became so popular.
And, Bob, you have a picture on your website, boblilly.com, of you tackling Jim Brown. And you guys played him and the Browns, you know, once or twice a year from 61 when you entered the league to 65 when he retired from the league. And you held him under 100 yards every game except for one. What do you remember?
The one in Dallas.
Yeah, except for that one. Well, what do you remember about matchups with him?
Okay, well, of course, Coach Landry, pardon me. Coach Landry had come from the Giants. They were in the same league as the Browns. The Browns were in our conference, the Browns and the Steelers both. So it was the Browns, the Steelers, the Redskins, the Giants, the Cardinals, the Eagles, and us, I think. That was it. Anyway, we were all in the same conference, and whenever, I think 68 is when the Browns and the Steelers went into the AFL. So I got to play against the Browns up through 68, and then they went into another conference. But Jim Brown did play. I think I played against him five times and played in the Pro Bowl with Jim a couple of years, at least two, maybe three. And anyway, Jim, the first year that I played with the Cowboys, I was a defensive end, which I had never played in my life. I was a defensive tackle all the way from high school up. And I was playing left defensive end, and so anyway, what I always wanted to do was just get the quarterback, or you know, go back and make a sack in the secondary, in the backfield or something, you know, make a big play, I guess you'd say. And playing defensive end, you've got to be not only, you know, a good pass rusher, but you've got to be cautious about them taking advantage of you when you don't know anything. And I didn't know much at that time. They ran more reverses and more quarterback, you know, he'd fake a handoff and then run around in. And they did all kinds of things. And anyway, I got Jim Brown one game. We played the Browns, and Jim, this was early, this was my rookie year. Jim was running toward the sideline, and I pursued over there, and I had him cut off, and I was standing probably about 5 foot up, ready to make the tackle. And he jumped completely over me, and I looked back, and he was going for a touchdown. And I'll never forget that as long as I live. That was my upcomings in the NFL, was watching Jim Brown's back sail down the field after jumping over me. And I'm ready to kill him. But the other game that you're talking about, we played in Dallas, and Jim, five guys hit him on the sideline. Five of our best tacklers, and none of us knocked him out of bounds. He scored a touchdown from about 30 yards out, and I think they gained 200 yards on that during that game. And I've always felt, and I still feel this way, that he was the best running back that I've ever seen. He was big. He was about 6'3", about 235, which was big back then. He could jump. He was agile. I mean, he could catch the ball. He was just a fabulous running back. I mean, and I think he's still recognized as one of the greatest ever. Mm-hmm. But I don't even know what he would do in this era. He might be a 3,000-yard runner in this era.
And Bob, back in 1963, you guys had to play a game against the Cleveland Browns. 2 days after President Kennedy was assassinated. And I read that the Browns fans were upset at you guys just for the mere fact that you were from Dallas. You know, they were throwing water bottles at you guys and that sort of thing. It was, you know, like the Cleveland Browns fans were taking out their grief on you guys, again, just, you know, because you're from Dallas. What do you remember about that game?
A lot. I remember not wanting to go, for one thing. We were out on the practice field on Friday before we left, and we used to go on Friday and spend the night Friday night and then go warm up at the stadium and then play the game on Sunday and come back after the game. But we were out on the practice field, and first of all, our equipment manager came out and he said, you know, we've had the president has been shot, but he's alive, he's in the hospital, and you know, that killed our practice, really. And then they came back out in a little while and said that President Kennedy had not made it. And so we were really down in the dumps. I mean, it was. We all wanted to go. We had even asked if we could go watch the him. He was doing a tour in Dallas, his motorcade and all. And so we weren't just because of our schedule. And anyway, we did not want to go to Cleveland and play football. We didn't even want to play football. And I don't think the Browns did either. They beat us pretty good, but I don't think they had their heart in it. We certainly didn't. And the fans were angry, and they were angry for another year. We had to go through that for about a year and a half, really. And that was the most difficult time of my career, was going through that aftermath of the assassination, because the people in these various NFL cities just had a bad taste in their mouth about Dallas. And I understand that. It's not something I disagree with. I just, you know, we certainly had nothing to do with it, but it happened. And we kind of had to fight our way out of it. And I think with people came in, like Bob Hayes came in shortly after that, and we had Roger come in a few years later, and, you know, other players that Meredith was another one that was already there. But these guys stepped up to the plate, and we started playing better football. And when we started getting the playoffs, people, they relented, and then they became our fans. It was sort of an interesting thing during my career to go through that and then end up with everybody cheering you, you know, when you came out. Mm-hmm. It was kind of very unusual. And anyway, I never forget it. I don't think anybody that was alive during that time would ever forget that day.
Bob, one more for Bob before we let him go.
Sure. And what stands out on your resume, Bob, and I'm sure is one of the more things that you're most proud of, is the fact that you never missed a game. And over the course of that long of a career, there had to be games. And we've talked to guys like this over the years, Bob. It was a different era, I understand. But there had to be games where you're saying to yourself, my goodness, I shouldn't be out here, but something made you get on that field. It's a lot different now, maybe because of the money, Bob, but there had to be a lot of pride in that record.
Well, you know, I guess there is. It was something that was not abnormal for me. Our players of my particular era, mm-hmm. we played that way in high school because we never had enough players. We only had 18 in Throckmorton, and we had quite a few more than Pendleton. But you know, you just learn to play hurt. I mean, I don't know. A lot of guys back then were from the farm or from whatever, and you always had some kind of small injury or something. But I played with compound fractures and various things. I played with all that, torn up knees. I mean, cast on my wrist, cast on my leg. And I didn't play well two or three games, and then all of a sudden it felt better and I played pretty well. But I learned a lot of things. I learned, you know, I got much tougher, and I learned to take my own knee, and I did that most of my career with Elasticon, which was a great thing, and it substituted for a ligament. And, you know, it was amazing because it really helped me in the long run, because when people could clip me from then on, they could clip me, which they did all the time back then, and my knee would give a little, but it wouldn't break. And so they couldn't block me from that side. And I didn't pay any attention to them. So, you know, it's funny how things work out. But I went through my career like that, and most of my teammates did the same thing. Cornell Green, I'll never forget. He was a great – I heard you talking earlier about a free agent. And Cornell was a free agent, and he came to – he was a basketball player, never played football, came to the Cowboys. He was really looking good in practice, and then all of a sudden he went downhill, and he came up to me one day and he said, Bob – he said, I don't know what's wrong, but he said, you know, my thighs, they're really raw and I'm bleeding. And so anyway, I said, let me look at your practice pants. And he had his thigh pads in backwards. And if you know what thigh pads looked like, they were going the wrong way. And So it was rubbing him raw. Well, he changed him back, and the next week, Coach Landry got up and said, "You know, Cornell," he said, I want to highlight a player that's. I was about to cut him last week, and he said he's made the most improvement of anybody I've ever seen. That's Cornell Green, and Cornell made All-American in basketball in Utah at Logan, Utah, which school that is? Utah State or Utah? I don't know which. Anyway. He turned out to be a fantastic basketball player there, and a football player for the Cowboys. And he went on to Denver with Dan Reeves when Dan went to be the head coach, and he has been their scout. He retired in 75, but he was their head scout in 75 and a few years behind that. And anyway, he said recently, he said, "Well, if I'd have stayed another year, I'd had another Super Bowl ring." But anyway, that's just, you play with injuries. He played with a broken ankle in several games, had a broken ankle. It was as big as a watermelon. I mean, it was incredible. I don't know how he even ran, but he did it. And
wow.
So it's inspiration. It's watching people like that that do these things that play, you know, they play hurt. And we had to. We didn't have many people. And so some of these guys are my heroes. I mean, Roger Staubach's another one. I mean, he played his little finger was sticking straight out on his passing hand. And they had to tape it in to keep it so that he could throw the ball.
Oh, and wow.
His tail sticks out. But these guys were tough. I mean, they were really tough. And the players today, I'm sure, are the same way. They just have more of them, and, you know, they can substitute a lot more freely than we did. But I would never trade my era for anything in the world. It was fabulous.
Bob, before we let you go, let our listeners know about your website. Again, I mentioned it a little bit ago, boblilly.com. Talk about what they can find on it, and you know, stay up to date with all the things that, you know, you've done over the course of your career and what you're doing now.
Well, now I'm kind of getting old, and I'm semi-retired. My hobbies, though, I'm 77. I just turned 77, which is I just couldn't believe it when I hit 70, but here I am, 77. My hobbies are photography, which has been a hobby of mine since I was a senior in college. I made one of the All-American teams was called the Coaches All-American Team, sponsored by Kodak, and we all got a camera. We went up to New York, and they gave us 200 rolls of film, prepaid mailers, and so I had a darkroom starting the next year, and I've had one ever since. It's now a digital darkroom, but I still have a darkroom, and I call it a darkroom. It's really not, but it's a digital darkroom, as we call it, and I'm still involved in it, and I've had a blast. I've done Sam Blair, who was the sports editor for the morning news in Dallas, and I did a book called Bob Lilly's Reflections, and it's kind of a photo essay of different players. It's really out of print. It's been a long time ago, but it was fun to do, and I printed up about 500 prints of my old teammates, and I think there's about 200 or 250 of those prints in that book. And I did it anyway. I mainly like landscape photography because I love to go out and scout the country and scout the, you know, the mountains and the deserts and all that and the ghost towns and take photographs. So that's my hobby in today's world. And I'd still do quite a few public. I do public appearances, but I also do a lot of just personal things, you know, for local charities and things like that. And I'm still involved with the Cowboys. I give out the Bob Lilly Award each year, and we usually go to about 3 games a year. And we have 12 grandchildren, so we're pretty busy. And anyway, we're just living, you know, and we're blessed.
Wow, that's great stuff. Bob, thank you so much for taking time out of your night to be a part of the show with us. We hope you'll come back and join us again sometime. You know, share more of your stories and your insights with us. You got 1,000 of them. We got 1,000 questions, and it's never enough time with sure. someone like no, you. But we hope you'll come back and do it again sometime.
Well, I'll be happy to. Just give me a call. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thanks, Bob. Bye-bye. Thanks to you and your wife, Ann, and all the best to your family.
You're welcome. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. That is Cowboys Hall of Fame defensive tackle Bob Lilly. Wow, Bob, what a thrill.
Well, you're talking, we use the term a lot, a legend who played for a legendary team with some legendary teammates. And you're right, Chris, we'd have to get him back to talk. You and I cut our teeth on these teams in the 70s. You know, your Jethro Pugh's and your Chuck Howley's and Leroy George. I lost count after 12 Hall of Famers that he played alongside of, which is ridiculous. So, yeah, my goodness, what a pleasant man, which I had heard prior to the radio cast tonight. So that's why I suggested we try to get a hold of him. And he's a terrific person, Chris, and as down-to-earth as you're going to get for being such a legend, but also scored 3 touchdowns in his career. We'll have to talk to him about that next time.
Yeah, absolutely. And, yeah, it's such a thrill when you get to speak to someone like him. And, you know, like I said, 1,000 questions, you know, inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame and the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Oh, by the way, in the same year. So you got to wonder what that must have been like for him to be honored like that. And like you say, Bob, you look back and he was a member of the NFL's all decade team for the 60s and the 70s. And unbelievable, player that he was. But on top of that, wow, he just sounded like such a wonderful man. And hopefully we do get the honor of having him back on the show again sometime.
I hope so, Chris.
All right, when Bob and I come back, we'll be turning on the Thursday Night Tailgate spotlight on the positive. Then we'll wrap up the show, and we're going to do that on the other side of these words from our friends over at Coastal Orthopedics and Kyven Foods.
Are you suffering from chronic pain in your shoulders, hips, knees, or wrists? Tired of living life with an old injury that just won't go away? If you answered yes to either of these questions, we can help. At Coastal Orthopedics and Sports Medicine, Dr. Candelora and his fine staff of medical professionals will get you back on the road to recovery. Their state-of-the-art facility and attention to detail will ensure you will be enjoying life again and feeling invincible in no time. Since 1991, Dr. Candelora and Coastal Orthopedics have been specializing in joint replacement, arthritis, and osteoporosis care, as well as pediatric and adult general orthopedics. Visit us on the web, www.bone-dr.com, or call our Newport Richey office just north of Tampa at 727-848-1417. Proud sponsors of Mike Ditka's The Gridiron Greats Assistance Fund.
This is Reggie Kelly, former Cincinnati Bengals and Atlanta Falcon tight end, and I'm the owner of Kyven Foods. And if you enjoy delicious food, you're going to love my Kyven products, which consists of our honey apple salsa, sweet barbecue sauce, and an array of seasonings. For store locations, online orders, and recipes, check out our website at www.kyven82.com. That's KYVAN82.com. One taste, and you'll appreciate the goodness.
Hey, welcome back. This is Todd Washington, 2-time Super Bowl champ, offensive line coach for the Baltimore Ravens, and you are listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with my boys Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari on the Armed Forces Radio Network. Go get them, guys.
And we're back here on Thursday Night Tailgate, and we're turning on our spotlight on the positive. Bob, who do you have for us this week?
Well, Chris, knowing that we had a Hall of Famer on the show, I'm thinking to myself, get a younger guy. Think about a younger guy who might have Hall of Fame potential, who's doing some great things in the community. And right away, Chris, and I think you would agree that he's Hall of Fame worthy, Antonio Gates. Looking at what this guy has done throughout his career, just a few things, Chris. He's has this annual Shop with a Charger event. He'll bring an underprivileged youth or a group in the San Diego area out shopping. He's very, very involved in the Huntington's Disease Society of America, where he does a basketball event. It's called Shoot to Cure HD, free throw shooting, and that raises a lot of money for that society. And but he also is very loyal to his hometown of Detroit, where he will give an annual free football camp every year. And not just him, Chris, and I was reading also about his wife, Sasha, who does an incredible amount beyond his foundation. She has a foundation. They provide wigs to women that have had hair loss from some, you know, ridiculously bad illnesses. And she tries to give them that, maintain that strong sense of beauty while they're going through these terrible battles and everything. But we may have mentioned Antonio in the past, but we can't talk enough about what he and his wife continue to do. And that's a guy who was a tremendous athlete at Kent State and is very, very involved in charitable efforts, Chris.
Yeah, no, that's great stuff, Bob. And Bob, for me, and I'm going to put the spotlight on Brett Favre and Deanna Favre, and kind of going back to the top of the show where we were talking about, you know, the Hall of Fame induction ceremonies. But you know, they've got their Favre for Hope Foundation, which provides support for disadvantaged and disabled children, plus aid for breast cancer patients as well. You know, his wife Deanna is a breast cancer survivor. They've raised over $7 million so far, and that money goes to a variety of different charities like the Make-A-Wish Foundation, the Ronald McDonald House, Special Olympics, the Children's Center for Communication and Development, Ribbon of Hope, the Pink Ribbon Fund, and Memorial Hospital down in Gulfport, Mississippi. Brett's held several Legends flag football games, and they raised, you know, for example, $10,000 for police family survivors, another $10,000 for professional firefighters up in Wisconsin, $40,000 for the Rawhide Boys Ranch, and $40,000 for Ribbon of Hope, which, again, you know, supports breast cancer patients. So I wanted to put the spotlight on them for the great things that they continue to do. Kudos to Brett and Deanna Favre for the great job that they are doing to raise funds for so many wonderful organizations. So, Bob, between, you know, Brett Favre and his wife Deanna, Antonio Gates, some great folks that are doing great things for a bunch of different folks that really need it.
And with Hall of Fame numbers and Hall of Fame credentials like they have, they'll probably be able to continue it for a long time.
That's right. So, folks, you know, please, you know, every week here on Thursday Night Tailgate, you know, you tune in, hear the spotlight on the positive. You know, we want, you know, and this is, you know, something that, you know, that Tony alluded to earlier tonight, right? We always hear about the negative things that athletes are doing, you know, football players, it doesn't matter, you know, in any sport, right? We hear, you know, all those sort of things are hammered into us when someone goes down the wrong path. We see it on CNN headline news. We see it on ESPN news. The crawler's at the bottom of the screen. We see it on the front pages of whether it's, you know, on the very front page of a newspaper or a website, or certainly in the sports section. So, you know, tune in here to Thursday Night Tailgate, because what we want to do is we want to make sure that you know it's the vast majority. By vast majority, I want to say it's 98 or 99% of the guys that are out there doing great things in their communities, in the, you know, in the home regions, or, you know, where they play, whether it's pro, you know, in the pro game, or, you know, in on the college level. So many of those guys are doing great things to have a positive influence and an impact on those communities. We want to make sure that you hear about those stories, so that, you know, what we're trying to do is let you know, and let's try to change a culture, right? We hear so many, you know, so much about the negative stuff, and we talk about most other sports shows are spending the majority of their time telling you, you know, ranting and raving about whether it's, you know, poor performances or guys doing wrong and all that sort of stuff. We want to be the antithesis of that, right? Here on Thursday Night Tailgate, we want to spotlight the positive. We want to let you know about the great things and the great games and the fun times and the good stories that these players, you know, lived through and got to experience, and we want to share those with you. We hope you'll come back and you'll hear that every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Right, Bob?
Absolutely. That's why we're here.
That's exactly right. All right, folks, it is time for Bob and I to put a bow on this episode. We want to thank again to, you know, Fred McCrary, Tony Collins, JR Redmond, Ronnie Brown, and Bob Lilly for joining us tonight. And like I say every single week here on TNT, Bob, the best part of it, of all of that, is getting to spend my Thursday nights with you, my friend.
Same to you, Chris, and you have a safe trip back, and, you know, you'll get back to more moist heat very soon.
That's right. All right, next week, who do we have scheduled to join us? Well, our good friend and former Steelers, Seahawks, and Patriots linebacker Chad Brown going to be back with us. Always a good time talking to Chad. Looking forward to that. Former hockey all-star Bernie Nichols will join us. He was originally scheduled to join us this week, needed to reschedule, so we look forward to talking with him next week. Former Cardinals defensive back Kwame Lassiter is going to be making his TNT debut with us. And former Raiders and Lions quarterback and TNT Hall of Famer Rusty Hilger going to be back with us. You're going to have to snap your chin strap on, because anytime that Rusty's a part of the show, boy, it's as soon as the mic goes live, boom, there's Rusty, and away he goes. So be prepared to hang on for dear life when Rusty joins us next week. Always a good time, though. We love Rusty. And, of course, Tony Collins is going to be here in his regular weekly time slot. So we hope you'll be back with us as well. I want to remind everyone how you can follow us on social media. Please, go to Facebook, give our Facebook page, our Thursday Night Tailgate Facebook page a like, and you can interact with us there. If you've got a question for a guest that you'd like for us to ask on your behalf, please share it with us there. Bob and I also have our individual Facebook pages, Bob Lazzari, Chris Mascaro. You can interact with us there. On Twitter, I am at CT Mascaro. Bob is at Bob_Lazzari, and the show is at TNT Podcast. Plus, you can stream or download any of our archive episodes from our website, ThursdayNightTailgate.com. You can also find us on great podcasting sites. So if you've got a particular favorite podcasting site that you have on your smartphone, or you've got downloaded on your computer, you can find us on places like iHeartRadio, TuneIn, Blog Talk Radio, Podbean, Spreaker, Stitcher, Audio Boom, Player.fm, SoundCloud. We're all over the net. So any one of those that's your favorite and your download or streaming site of choice, you can find us on there as well. Bob, take us home, my friend.
Okay, Chris. Again, have a safe trip. And our thanks go out to our announcer, Joe Lajanusa, for the great job he does with our weekly intro and ads, and to James Brocato and all the guys from Painted Faces for our upcoming outro music. And on behalf of myself and Chris, we thank everyone tonight for listening. We appreciate you the most. Until next week, good night, Kevin. We miss you.